Matthew. Pleasure to be here. Really nice seeing this turn out. First, thank you to Bonnie for the hosting today, and to Dan and Marty for the hospitality and bringing me here, and I'm very grateful. So let's see, starting off, I basically don't know anybody here, so I feel free to ask all sorts of invasive personal questions. How many of you here have a family member with a history of heart disease? Cancer. Stroke. High blood pressure. Ulcers, my God, there's a hand there that's not even going there. How many of you have a family member with a really bad case of leprosy? No hands. No hands. How about that cousin you're sitting next to at Thanksgiving who goes to the bathroom every 10 minutes because of their dysentery? Not that either. How about that special relative who's just teeming with liver parasites the size of fists? Just a few hands. Okay. Well, that's surprising. I'll believe it that very few of us in here seriously worry about smallpox or scarlet fever. Few of us come down with malaria during the rainy season. Few of our mothers died in childbirth. Nobody in this room is malnourished. We're not like normal animals. We don't get sick like normal animals do. We don't die like normal animals. Basic off-the-rack mammal, what happens to it? It drinks some contaminated water, and it's dead 2 days later from dehydration. What do we do instead? We spend 80 years having our bodies go to hell on us. So we think, oh great, I gotta listen to this for the next hour. That's wonderful news. That's westernized disease. With the exception of AIDS, tuberculosis, we don't worry about the infectious diseases, diseases of poor nutrition, poor hygiene. Instead, we live well enough and long enough that our bodies slowly fall apart over time. And this is westernized disease. Okay, to give you a sense of the century ago or so, 1900, turn of the century, what do you think the leading causes of death in the United States? TB, good, what else? Childbirth. If you were a woman between ages 20 and 40, the single medically riskiest thing you could do is attempt to give birth. Tuberculosis, pneumonia, number one on the list, the flu. The flu, nobody under 100 dies of the flu anymore. 1918, worst winter in World War I, people being blown out of trenches all over Europe, and if you were sent to the war that winter, your chances of surviving were better than if you got the flu. 8 million war deaths in World War I, 40 million dead civilians. Nobody dies of the flu anymore. Instead, we die of these totally bizarre diseases that never used to exist before in any sort of numbers on this planet. Weird diseases like cancer and heart disease and diabetes and Alzheimer's, and these are very, very different ways of getting sick than normal animals do. I mean, 20,000 years ago, you're some 20-year-old hunter-gatherer, you've just screwed up, you've made a major medical mistake, you've just eaten some reed buck riddled with anthrax, and the medical outcome's absolutely clear. You've got a 3-day life expectancy. These days, as a 20-year-old, you make a major medical mistake, you've decided a healthy diet consists of a lot of red meat and saturated fats and maybe a beer every other day or so, and it's not at all clear what the medical outcome is going to be. You may be dead in your grave at 50, or you may be running marathons with your grandkids when you're 85. And in lots of ways, the central question in medicine these days is, so why do some of us last to 50 and some to 85? Now, some of it's got to do with like nuts and bolts biology, what your liver does with cholesterol and stuff like that, but some of it's got to do with issues that nobody ever had to think about before in medicine. Totally weird questions like, what's your psychological makeup? Or what's your social status? Or how do people with your social status get treated in your society? Or how about this one? Get the answer to this question, and you will have done more good for human health than anyone since Jonas Salk. Why is it that when we feel as if nobody loves us, we eat M&Ms? Well, that's got something to do with it. Solve that one, and you've solved half the cases of adult onset diabetes in this country. This is a really weird world we've entered here, starting from smallpox at that end, and now trying to make sense of love and Oreo cookies. This is a very strange world we've entered, and trying to make sense of who of us are sick and who of us are healthy. And when you look at these diseases that you listen to, these diseases of westernized lifestyle and slow accumulation of damage, these are diseases that are predominantly caused by or are made worse by stress. And most of us in this room will have the profound westernized luxury of dropping dead someday of a stress-related disease. Nonetheless, amid that being wonderful news, it's better if that happens later rather than sooner. This is a subject worth learning about. Okay, so we start off with obligatory definitions. I start off with a term. I guarantee you all heard this word in ninth grade biology. With any luck, you've not thought about it since then. Remember homeostasis? Homeostasis, having an ideal body temperature, having an ideal level of glucose in your bloodstream, having an ideal everything, being in homeostatic balance. A stressor is anything in the outside world that knocks you out of homeostatic balance. You're some zebra, a lion has leapt out, ripped your stomach open, your innards are dragging in the dust, and you still need to get out of there. This counts as being out of homeostatic balance. Or you're that lion who's half starved to death, and if you don't chase after that zebra successfully, you're not going to survive the night, a short-term physical crisis. The stress response is what you do with your body. You secrete adrenaline and 11 other hormones I won't torture you with. The stress response is what you do to reestablish homeostatic balance. That's all you need to know if you're a zebra or a lion. If you're a human, though, you've got to expand the definition in a critical way, which is, yes, a stressor can be when your body's been knocked out of homeostatic balance. In addition, a stressor can be when you think you're just about to be knocked out of homeostatic balance. And if it turns out that you're right, hooray for you, ooh, here comes an elephant, maybe I'll increase my blood pressure before it stops me rather than after. An anticipatory stress response can be very helpful. But on the other hand, if you think you're just about to be knocked out of homeostatic balance, and you're really not, and you think that way all the time, there are medical ways of describing you. You're being neurotic as hell. You're being anxious, you're being paranoid, you're being hostile, you're being profoundly human. Sit down a hippo and try to describe what the primal ending rate is, and it's going to have no idea what you're talking about. But we do. And that's the critical point of the whole field. We humans go and turn on the exact same stress response as does that zebra or that lion, and we turn it on for purely psychological reasons. And the punchline of the entire field is, that's not what the stress response evolved for. For 99% of the beasts on this planet, stress is about 3 minutes of screaming terror in the savannah, after which it's over with, you're over with, and what do? We turn on the same stress response for 30-year mortgages. And the punchline of the field is, that's not what it evolved for. And if you turn on the stress response chronically, you're going to get sick. That's why we humans are more prone towards stress-related diseases than any other species out there. We're smart enough to have invented this thing, chronic psychological stress. Now, this whole picture I'm describing here, if you think about it, just seems a little bit odd. Okay, so you're the zebra, you're injured, you're bleeding, you're hypotensive, or you're that lion, you're starving, you're hypoglycemic. These are very different bodily states. And one of the things they train into your head in biology is your body comes up with a very specific solution to a very specific problem. If you're hot, you don't shiver, you do something very different from that. Yet here's the stress response system, which you turn on if you were that zebra, that lion, injured, starving, too hot, too cold. Why should you turn on the same stress response in such different circumstances? Now, this was an issue that was wrestled with by the guy who's officially the godfather of stress physiology, the guy who started the field, this Austrian physician in the 1930s named Hans Selye. Selye was very smart and very creative and very intuitive and very insightful, and apparently he was totally lame at handling lab rats. And that's how he started the field. Selye was this young assistant professor, and he was looking for some project to study, and some biochemist down the hall had just isolated some hormone out of somebody's pancreas. Nobody knew what this stuff did. So Selye decides, okay, I'm going to figure out the effects of this pancreatic stuff on the body. So you're Selye, what do? You go down the hall, you get a bucket load of the hormone stuff from your buddy, and you come back, and you start injecting rats with it. And apparently, he simply was not very good at handling lab rats. So he's in there every day with the rats, injecting the rats and dropping the rats and chasing the rats, and the rats chasing him like half the morning with a broom getting out from underneath the sink there. Months of this go by, he checks out the rats and he discovers something amazing. All the rats have stomach ulcers. Selye is euphoric. he's just discovered the effects of this pancreatic crow on the body. It gives you a peptic ulcer. Great. Now, fortunately, being a good scientist, he's been running a control group as well. A bunch of rats, but he's been injecting them with saline instead of with the pancreatic stuff. So he's been in there every day with the control rats, injecting them, dropping them, chasing them, chasing them. And he checks out the control rats, and they all have stomach ulcers. Okay, so your basic scientist at this point gives up and goes to business school. But some of these rats, this is screwed. I'm seeing the same exact thing with the controls from the experimentals. It can't have anything to do with the pancreatic stuff. What do they have in common? Well, pretty inept at handling these guys. They can't be having such a hot time with this. Maybe what I'm seeing is some sort of non-specific response of the body to generalized unpleasantries. And Sellier's insight now was to systematically expose rats to generalized unpleasantries. He put some of them up on the roof of the building in the winter, down in the boiler rooms, or rooms with loud noises, or rooms with cat pee, and he always sees the same thing, which is they get a stomach ulcer. We know exactly what Sellier had discovered. This was the tip of the iceberg of stress-related disease. And Sellier was the person who took this obscure term from metallurgy, talking about torsional strains on metal. Sellier was the one who said these animals are under stress, and there's a system in the body which gets activated, which saves them from stress, but if the stress goes on for too long, they're going to get sick. Everybody thought he was out of his mind. Because again, you get trained, your body comes up with a very specific solution to a very specific challenge, and here's Sellier with his imaginary stress response, which you turn on exactly the same if you're injured, starving, too hot, too cold, or on a blind date. Why should this be? Why should you turn on the same stress response system in your body in such different circumstances? And it turns out, if you think about it, it makes perfect sense. Because whether you are that zebra or that lion, if you're going to survive the crisis, there's very similar things you need to do. First off, you need energy. Not energy tucked away in your fat cells for some building project next spring. Energy right now in the circulation to power your muscles. And with the onset of stress, adrenaline, other facets of the stress response, you go to your storage sites in your body, your fat, your liver, you go to the bank and you empty out the savings accounts and you turn it into cash. Glucose in your bloodstream, all perfectly logical whether you are that zebra or that lion sprinting in that way. Now, the next thing you do makes perfect sense as well. You've just had all this amazing biochemistry and dumped all this energy in the bloodstream. You want to deliver it as fast as possible to your muscles. You increase your heart rate. You increase your blood pressure, your breathing rate, your cardiovascular tone, all as part of the strategy. Get that glucose, get that oxygen to your thigh muscles in 2 seconds instead of three. You're that much more likely to survive. Now, with the onset of stress, you also shut down all sorts of long-term building projects. You don't worry about the long-term planning if you're not sure if there is a long-term. If there's a tornado due this afternoon, you don't spend a day outside gardening. You shut down everything that's not essential. You shut down digestion. By definition, if you're that lion, you're not staggering up from some all-you-can-eat buffet. And if you're the zebra, the energy you're mobilizing in the first line you're getting from your fat cells in like 2 seconds, digestion takes forever. It's slow, it's expensive, and this is no time for it. You're trying to avoid eating somebody's lunch. You've got better things to do than digest breakfast. And we all know the first step of this. Suppose you get stressed speaking in public. What happens? Your mouth gets dry. You've stopped secreting saliva, the first step of shutting down your whole gastrointestinal tract. With the onset of stress, you shut down growth, you shut down reproduction. Big, expensive, optimistic things to be doing with your body, and this is no time for it. You know, look, you're running for your life, there's a lion 2 steps behind you, you know, ovulate some other time. Kick your face some other time, grow antlers next week, you'll even think about sperm. With the onset of stress, growth hormone disappears from the bloodstream, tissue repair disappears, every sex hormone on earth, also do it later if there is a later. Next, so you're that zebra and your innards are dragging in the dust, and this might be a good time to perk up your immune system a little bit just to protect you from an infection. With the onset of stress, immune defenses get better. Finally, with the onset of stress, there's an array of stress hormones that get into the brain, and short-term, they do great stuff. They make you more alert. You release this neurotransmitter dopamine, which makes you feel good and in the moment there. Your sensory thresholds get better. Your memory gets better. That's that whole flashbulb memory phenomenon. I'm willing to bet every single one of us in this room will remember for the rest of our lives exactly where we were when we heard the news that Britney Spears had shaved her head. You need some kind of message to your brain saying, this one is important. Look at what you're doing here. You're shutting off the sun's unessential. You're delivering energy where it's needed. You're making your immune system work better. You're thinking more clearly, perfectly adaptive, wonderful if you were that zebra or that lion. And all you need to do to appreciate that is look at a couple of weirdo human diseases where people can't turn on the stress response. One of them is called Addison's disease, another is Shy-Drager syndrome. These are not diseases where now you're more at risk for cancer. These are diseases where the guy goes running for the commuter bus one morning and drops dead from hypoglycemic shock. If you plan to sprint across the savannah or sprint across a parking lot, you had better turn on the stress response or else you've got a 30-second life expectancy. So our first critical take-home message here, if you plan to get stressed like a normal mammal, you would better turn on the stress response. For most of us, though, far more important is that issue of, so what if you turn on the stress response too long, too often, for purely psychological reasons, and you wind up getting sick? Now, Selye, 80 years ago, was the first person to wrestle with this puzzle. Why is it that chronic stress makes us sick? And he came up with an answer that dominated the field for the next 40 years, which is too bad because he was totally wrong. Okay, here's what we do. Stressor comes along, knocks you out of homeostatic balance, you turn on the stress response, you reestablish homeostasis, that's great, but the stressor keeps going. And you enter what Selye called the exhaustion phase. Your body runs out of the stress response. Your adrenals run out of adrenaline. Your pituitary runs out of its stress hormones. It's like your military runs out of ammunition and you're left defenseless there just being pummeled by these invaders. This turned out to be total fantasy. There was no such thing as an exhaustion phase. There's never been an organism that's been so stressed that they run out of adrenaline. The problem isn't that your military runs out of ammunition. The problem is that after a while, you're spending so damn much on your military that you don't need to have health care or social services or education. Okay, what you see after a while is the stress response becomes more damaging than the stressor itself, especially when the stressor was some psychological nonsense. Everything you're doing here is inefficient and penny-wise and dollar-foolish, but you gotta do it because today's an emergency. And for psychological reasons, every day is an emergency. You never plan ahead, you never repair, you never grow. You pay a price in every one of these realms. At the energetic level, if you're constantly mobilizing energy because of psychological stress, one consequence is you get atrophy of one of the main places in your body where you store energy, your muscles. Myopathy, loss of muscle mass, stress-induced myopathy. For extremely complicated reasons, you're also exhausted all the time. For insanely complicated reasons, you are more at risk for adult-onset diabetes. Now, this is one of those diseases that our great-great-great-great-grandparents never heard of. This is a disease of aging in a typically westernized way, getting more sedentary, putting on weight. This once totally obscure disease is just on the edge of being the number one killer in this country, and everything that goes wrong in any cell in your body with adult-onset diabetes made worse by stress. How about the cardiovascular level? Okay, so you're running for your life from a lion, your blood pressure is 180 over 120, you're not suffering from high blood pressure, you're saving your life. You get blood pressure in that range every time you're stuck in traffic, you're not saving your life, you are suffering from stress-induced hypertension. And if you do it chronically enough, you will damage your cardiovascular system. Okay, 30 seconds on stress and heart disease. What's the scenario we all know about? A guy gets horrible news, he's wailing, whatever, he suddenly clutches his chest in pain, keels over dead, sudden cardiac arrest. This is a movie plot. This never happens in the real world. What happens instead requires you to understand why, like, your toilet bowl plumbing wears out after a while. He got a tube, and he got fluid moving through it, and by definition, if the fluid moves with more force, if you've increased your blood pressure, you begin to get fluid turbulence, little bits of eddies and stuff that pound away on the walls of your blood vessels and cause microscopic bits of pitting and scarring there, and that's just where fat and glucose and cholesterol and inflammation wants to glom onto and clog your arteries. Where's the fat and glucose and cholesterol coming from? That's the stuff that you're mobilizing into your circulation in the first place. You get this double whammy between your metabolic and your cardiovascular stress response, setting you up for cardiovascular disease, number one killer in this country. Now, this connection between stress and heart disease is so solid that it accounts for the most famous personality profile in all of medicine. And if all of you people are coming out here on a nice evening to sit here in the dark instead, I'm willing to bet like 80% of you in here qualify as having this. Those of us in here who have type A personality. Okay, what's the deal with type A? Type A was first described by a pair of cardiologists in the 50s in San Francisco, Friedman and Rosenman. Original formulation, time pressure, hostile, impatient, low self-esteem, joyless striving. Okay, like 90% of us are here. And what these guys reported was, if this is what you're like, you're more at risk for heart disease. Cardiologists hated these guys. You're some 1950s Ozzie and Harriet cardiologist, and all you're trained to think about are like heart valves and blood lipids, and no one's to hear these guys say, no, what you need to do is sit down your patient and talk to them. Christ, who wants to talk to their patient? Talk to their patient and say something like, okay, suppose you're in the supermarket and you've picked the line that's going slowest. Do you go berserk at that moment? That's got something to do with heart disease. Total resistance to the concept, and it wasn't clear till the 80s with enough studies that type A is for real, big time. If you have type A personality, you are more at risk for heart disease than if you smoke, than if you have elevated cholesterol levels, and if you were overweight, huge risk factor. And by the 80s, what people had figured out was the key variable in that personality profile, something that is now called toxic hostility. It's this attributional style where everything that happens is proof that they're out to get you, they're out to get you more than anybody else. The only thing you can do is have a knife drawn and watch your back 24/7. It's this whole style where you're in the supermarket and you pick the slow line and you want to kill the son of a bitch, kill me on the cash register. Come on, how does your wife at 1 o'clock and you can do this just to screw you up? No, go ask the old lady how she is today. Come on. If this is what you're doing then, instead of checking out the Elvis sightings in the National Enquirer, you're a this is what you do every time somebody could have held the elevator door open for you but didn't just to get at you. Your blood pressure is going to soar 40 times a day. You are going to pay the price of that. These days, the big question in this field of research is, insofar as you are toxically hostile, what's worse for your heart, expressing the hostility or keeping it repressed inside? What's clear is expressing is worse for everybody else's heart. What's the physiological cost of repressing strong emotion? Very active area of research. Okay, so that's the connection between stress and heart disease. Actually, great question. How did these guys ever figure out about type A personality? How did they discover it? And I got to hear this story a few years ago from the horse's mouth himself, Meyer Friedman, then in his 90s, died a few years ago in his early 90s, saw his last patient a week before he died, working full-time in the cardiology clinic, UCSF Medical Center. As he used to say, I'm still type A, but I'm a type A tortoise now. And here's this great story, because it is one of the great demonstrative examples of how science is not supposed to work. Okay, so it was the 50s, and Friedman and his partner had this cardiology practice in San Francisco. Everything was going great. There was this one problem, though, which is for some reason they were having to spend a fortune reupholstering the armchairs in their waiting room. What's this about? Who knows? Whatever. It's part of the overhead. Every month, the upholsterer comes, there's one or two chairs to repair. One month, the upholsterer went on vacation. Replacement upholsterer comes and takes one look at the chairs and discovers type A personality. He says, what is wrong with your patients? Nobody wears our chairs this way. And the guy was right, they have one chair left, and this is what it looks like. And what you can see is the front 2 inches of the seat cushion and the 2 inches of the armrest are totally shredded. The rest of the chair is fine. It's like each night there's dwarf beavers there. This is the type A profile. This is what a chair looks like if day in and day out, type A individuals are sitting there waiting to hear from their cardiologist if they've got bad news or not. These are people who are not just figuratively, but literally sitting on the edge of their seat and squirming and clawing. This is what a type A person does to the armchair when they're waiting to hear the news from the cardiologist. So what's supposed to happen now if things are working right? Like Friedman should grab him and say, good God, man, what you've discovered, like midnight conferences between upholsterers and cardiologists. teams of idealistic young upholsterers sweeping across America, coming back with news that no, we don't find chairs like these in dentists' offices. That's what should have happened. What actually happens, here's where 90-year-old Dr. Friedman started looking all sheepish. She says, I told my nurse, get this man away from me, I'm this important cardiologist, stop wasting my time, give him this damn check. He was too type A to listen to the guy. And it wasn't until 5 years later that he was collaborating with psychologists, out pops the type A profile, and they say, oh my God, the upholsterer, he was right. He was getting, I have no idea who that man was. Now, nothing to bet, right now in San Francisco, there's some bar in the Mission District, and there's some 95-year-old retired upholsterer there, and you get this guy going, and he's gonna go on and on about how he discovered type A personality. One of the dark chapters of my profession. Okay, digestive system. Digestive system. Back to Selway in the 1930s. Stress causes ulcers. Stress causes ulcers. First stress-related disease. Everybody knows this. Then, about 30 years ago, there was a revolution in ulcerology. And these two scientists discovered bacteria. And the bacteria is what causes the ulcers. A bacteria called Helicobacter pylorus, 90% of ulcers in the West are caused by this. It gets in your stomach and generates oxygen radicals and blows holes in the walls of your stomach. It was a bacterial disease, major, major discovery. These guys got the Nobel Prize for it. The evening this is announced, every gastroenterologist on Earth goes out and celebrates that evening. This is the greatest thing they've ever heard, because never again are they going to have to sit down with patients and make eye contact and say, so, anything stressful in your life? It's got nothing to do with stress. It's a bacterial disorder. It's doing some damn antibiotics. It's got everything to do with stress, because only 10% of the people with the bacteria get the ulcer. You've got to have the bacterial risk factor, but you also have to have a lifestyle risk factor there. What does stress do? It doesn't cause ulcers. Helicobacter does. What stress does is tell your stomach walls, don't bother starting to repair that baby ulcer today. Do it tomorrow. Do it tomorrow. We're in the middle of a crisis. Bacteria causes the ulcers. Stress impairs your stomach walls from their capacity to fix it. So stress remains very, very pertinent to the world of ulcerology. Growth, if you were a kid, all you are is one big long-term building project. And if for reasons of stress, your body keeps saying, don't bother today, do it tomorrow, you're going to impair growth. And at an extreme, you get one of the truly bizarre outposts of medicine, a disease of children who stop growing for purely psychological reasons, known as stress dwarfism, psychosocial dwarfism, psychogenic dwarfism. And these are kids who are years behind the normal growth rates, and there's no disease, there's no parasites, there's no malnutrition. You check your blood, there's no growth hormone. You give them synthetic growth hormone, nothing happens. The whole system is shut down, and you start poking around in their background, and out comes some appalling psychological stress that they're enduring. And the amazing thing is if you get them out of that setting, technical term, do a parodectomy on them, get them to a different setting, and growth resumes at that point. Now, I guarantee, get any textbook in endocrinology and look at the chapter on growth, and there is going to be the obligatory picture of a stressed dwarfism kid. You know those textbook pictures, it's always like this naked kid, stunted, naked with a rectangle over the eyes in front of the growth chart. And I guarantee you turn the page, and there's the obligatory follow-up picture from 2 years later, where the kid is now in a different setting, and they're like 6'14", and playing for the NBA, and so you're still naked with a rectangle, but everything else gets better. Is this is a syndrome where growth in every cell in the body is shut down for reasons purely of psychological stress. spectacular case study of this a few years ago. And this was a paper about a child who came from a very psychologically abusive background, brought into New York Hospital pediatric ward, and they showed that at the time that he came in, zero growth hormone in the bloodstream. Over the course of the next few months, he developed this close relationship with this one nurse. This was like the first normal emotional relationship in his life. After a few months in there, he had normal growth hormone levels for a child of his age. At that point, the nurse goes on vacation. By the end of the two-week vacation, he's back down to zero growth hormone. The nurse comes back, within a week, he's back up again. Think about this. The rate at which this child was depositing calcium in his long bones could be completely predicted by how safe and loved he was feeling. You cannot ask for a clearer example of what's going on here is affecting every cell throughout the body. Now, when you look at stress dwarfism, of course, the question becomes, so how common is this disease? If you are shorter than average and you're not obviously malnourished as a kid, are you a victim of stress dwarfism? Can you blame your parents for that? And it turns out, no, this is not, oh, when I was a kid, we moved all the time, very stressful, very stressful. This is not acrimonious divorce. This is nightmare psychopathology. This is when the police and the social workers break down the door of the apartment and find a child chained to the radiator and smeared and excremented. Total nightmare stuff, and get him out of that setting and growth resumes. General clinical consensus is this is a once-in-a-career disease that you see. This is incredibly rare. Except it's not so rare. It pops up in kids in war zones, kids in areas of civil strife. Research assistant of mine and I think we have the data to show the kids who wound up in the Japanese-American internment camps suffered from mild stress dwarfism. Anthropologists have done studies showing across cultures all over the planet, the more physically stressful the rites of passages during childhood, the more impairment of growth. Here's one example of this. So this is the creepiest example of stress dwarfism I've ever heard. If this doesn't unnerve you, you have like no imagination at all. Okay, if for some indefensible reason you ever find yourself reading chapter after chapter about growth hormone, you're going to find a weird pattern, which is a lot of these chapters make reference to Peter Pan. They start with a quote from Peter Pan or some slight comment about Tinkerbell. I'd seen this for years, I had no idea what this was about, until one day I finally found the explanation. And I was reading a chapter on psychological regulation and growth, and it was talking about stress dwarfism, gave the following case history. 1870s, Victorian England, 8-year-old boy growing up there. One day he sees his beloved 12-year-old brother killed in front of him in an accident. This destroys the family. There were no other siblings. The father was emotionally non-existent. This was the mother's favorite child. With this Victorian spoon, she takes to her bed with the shaves drawn for the next 10 years. This boy growing up in this complete emotional isolation. Things like he brings in a tray of food to his mother, and she's saying, oh, David, David, is that you, David? If you come to me, oh, David, David, the dead son. David, are you finally here? Oh, it's only you. Growing up being only you. Apparently, the only thing the mother ever spoke to him about was this crazy idea she grabbed onto, which was, if David had to die, at least he'll always be my perfect little boy. He didn't grow up. He never grew up into a man who doesn't need his mother anymore. He'll always be my perfect little boy. He didn't grow up, didn't grow up, didn't grow up. This kid hears this with a vengeance. Well-to-do family, no evidence of disease or malnutrition. He lives to be age 60, stops growing at that point. 4'10" is an adult, unconsummated marriage, dramatic, wild example of stress dwarfism. And then the chapter concludes by informing us that as an adult, this was the author of the much-beloved children's classic, Peter Pan. This was J.M. Barrie, the guy who wrote Peter Pan. This was an incredibly screwed up guy. All this guy did was write book after play after novella about boys who die and don't grow up and come back as ghosts and marry their mothers. His private journals were filled with sadomasochistic fantasies about little boys. This guy spent the rest of his life very unsuccessfully dealing with his stress dwarfism. So think about that the next time you see Johnny Depp in a movie. What else can I tell you that's disturbing? You're gonads. You're gonna go gonads. Your gonads are not going to be working very well if you're under chronic stress. If you're a female mammal of any species out there, if you are chronically stressed, your cycles will become irregular, lengthened, they may stop altogether. Stress-induced anovulation, stress-induced amenorrhea, and people understand exactly how this works. We know exactly which hormones are working at the brain, the pituitary, the ovaries, the uterus to shut down the system. Let me tell you about one of these steps because it's really interesting. And it has to do with a weird thing that female mammals do, including humans, which is they make a certain amount of male sex hormones, like testosterone, androgen hormones. Not a ton of the stuff, maybe 5% the levels you would find from a male. It's in the adrenal glands, adrenal androgens, 5%, not much. Nonetheless, you gotta get rid of the stuff. And fortunately, your basic female comes with this enzyme in her fat cells that can do like biochemistry 101. It takes the circulating androgens and turns them into estrogens and dumps them back into circulation. Great, fine, everybody lives happily ever after. What if you're stressed though? What if you're stressed like the locusts have come and eaten your crops and you've been subsisting on 800 calories a day? What if you're slowly starving? What if you're slowly being depleted of fat stores? And at some point, there's too few functional fat cells to do that little enzymatic trick of turning the androgens into the estrogens. You get into trouble for two reasons. One is you're putting less estrogen into the bloodstream, but more importantly, you're not breaking down the androgens and their levels build up and they shut down every step in the system. That's why starvation shuts down ovulation. That's why voluntary starvation, anorexia, does the same. A hallmark of anorexia is women stop ovulating really early on in the process. And that's why some women who do tons and tons and tons of athletics will stop ovulating after a while, because the critical threshold of fat to muscle ratio in the body is thrown off. Now, this has been studied tons. For example, in girls typically studying very serious gymnasts or ballet dancers. This was a study done a few years ago showing delay of onset of puberty. Study done of the Romanian Olympic gymnastic squad. You know, those are all those like 50-pound, 15-year-olds winning the gold medals. What was the average age at which these kids started menstruating? 19. 12 and a half is the Western average. And once you do hit puberty, you do tons of exercise. What the studies show, for example, is runners who run an average of 50 miles a week or more, that's typically in the range where fat stores are getting into the range where you begin to have ovulatory problems. Now, I could be telling you the exact same story about men as well. Men who run an average of 50 miles a week or more, on the average, sperm count begins to go down, mild testicular atrophy. Okay, wait a second, you're saying, I thought exercise was good for us. Yes, exercise is good for us. In fact, a lot of exercise is very good for us. That doesn't mean though that an insane amount of exercise is insanely good for you. It means too much of a good thing is just as bad as too little. You've passed the point of homeostatic balance. I mean, think about it, you know, as a thought experiment, sit down some hunter-gatherer from the Kalahari Desert and say, you know, where I come from, we have so much food and so much free time that sometimes we'll just go run 26 miles and sheer pleasure of it. They're going to say, are you out of your mind? I mean, that's stressful. And throughout hominid history, if you were running 26 miles in a day, either you are very intent on eating somebody, or somebody's intent on eating. This is not really good. So take that as sort of a cautionary note. Meanwhile, over at the male end of things, with the onset of stress, down go testosterone levels. Take some guy, anesthetize him for surgery, slice into his belly with a scalpel, and 10 minutes later, testosterone is plummeting. Take first-year male medical students during their exam periods down to testosterone levels, drop the rank of a baboon in his hierarchy down to his testosterone levels. Here's a stressor which, thank God, I have no personal experience with whatsoever. Apparently, I've read, it's not fun to be in the Marines. Apparently, it's kind of a drag, in fact. And this famous study, 1970, New England Journal of Medicine, looking at guys in ROTC Marine training during their training period, where now on top of everything else, they were having to pee into little Dixie cups for the psychiatrist. And back comes the finding, guys during the first few months in the Marines have the circulating androgen levels of like Vatican choir boys. And that's how the system is shut down. Major, major suppressive effect. Okay, so this whole phenomenon is very well understood. People know exactly which stress hormones are working at the brain, at the pituitary, the testes, to shut down testosterone secretion. Now, what you have to do is ask a critical follow-up question, which is, what are the consequences of testosterone levels dropping during stress? And amazingly, the answer winds up being, there's no consequences at all. Turns out testosterone is this vastly overrated hormone. It's like basically superfluous. You got a thimble full of the stuff and a few sperm and you're in business. You gotta knock out like 90% of the guy's testosterone levels to seriously impair fertility. What does stress do at the most? Maybe a 60, 70% decline. The problem during stress isn't that testosterone levels go down. The problem is that penises go down. I don't have to talk about this here in the state. Okay, finally, something you saw in this damn lecture. So heteroerections work. So, okay, what do you know? I just saw somebody here pick up a pen for the first time this year. Okay. Well, so how do you let erections work? In order to have an erection, you gotta have a spinal cord. Now, most of your spinal cord is boring stuff that makes you this chess and foxtrot and shift the gears in a car or whatever, but then there's a whole part of your spinal cord that does the good stuff. The stuff you normally have no conscious control over, like blushing and goose flesh and orgasms and pupillary contractions, things that you don't normally have any conscious automatic control over, thus termed the automatic nervous system, or the autonomic nervous system. Now, this autonomic nervous system comes in two parts. First part is called the sympathetic nervous system. Emergency, adrenaline, arousal, fight or flight, stress response, all hell breaking loose. Second half is called the parasympathetic nervous system. Calm vegetative function. You take a nap, you turn on the parasympathetic nervous system. You eat a starchy meal, you turn on the parasympathetic nervous system. You get to some battle by a predator, you turn off the parasympathetic nervous system. You turn on the sympathetic. They work in opposition. Okay, so here's the deal. In order to get an erection, you've got to turn on the parasympathetic nervous system. You have to be calm and vegetative. Okay, so you got your erection now. What happens next? Maybe something having to do with the social context that brought about the erection in the first place. Maybe for some reason you start feeling a little bit less calm and vegetative. Maybe you start breathing a little bit faster. Maybe your heart rate begins to increase. Maybe you're starting to turn on the sympathetic nervous system. And more time goes by, and now some of your muscles are working hard, and eventually you get to this point where you're breathing fast, you're gasping, you're sweating, your toes are curling, and eventually you reach this point where your whole body is screamingly sympathetic, except for this one little outpost where you're desperately holding on to parasympathetic as long as possible. Finally, you can't take it anymore. You turn off the parasympathetic, you turn on the sympathetic, and you ejaculate. So what happens when you're under stress? You're not very calm and vegetative. You're not very good at getting the erection in the first place. You can have stress and disinterest. Or you can have a second problem. Suppose you manage to get the erection, and then you think, oh my God, global warming, the ice caps, whatever. You accelerate that transition from parasympathetic to sympathetic too quickly. You suffer from premature ejaculation. Either you don't get the erection or things go too quickly. Incredibly easy for this to occur. Current estimates are 60% of the doctor's visits in this country by men with erectile dysfunction turns out not to have an organic disease basis. It has a psychogenic cause, a stress-related cause instead. Okay, second useful thing is eating. So how do you distinguish between a case of organic erectile dysfunction and psychogenic one? Guy comes to you, he hasn't been able to have an erection in the last 6 months during sex, and you wonder, well, maybe it's stress-related, or maybe he's got a pituitary tumor. Here's what you do to tell the difference. You take advantage of a weird thing that male primates do, including human males, which is when they go into REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep, when they go into REM sleep, they get erections. I have no idea why. I've talked to Earth's penis experts. Nobody has an explanation for this. The male primates get REM sleep erections. That's how it works. So here you've got this guy, and you're trying to figure out, is it stress? Is it pituitary tumor? You give him this handy-dandy little penile pressure cuff transducer thingy that he takes home, and just before he goes to sleep, he puts it on the base of his penis and wires it up and satellite relays and the next day you got your answer, which is that this guy hasn't had an erection during sex in the last 6 months, but 30 seconds into his first REM stage, he has a perfectly normal erection. He doesn't have a pituitary tumor, it's stress related. That's how you distinguish between the two. Do you still get the REM sleep, the nocturnal erection? Very easily done. Actually, it's not so easily done, because you got this electronic device, and it's cheating, and wires, and shirts, and electric heat, and that's a stressor in and of itself. Here's what is actually done in the majority of sexual dysfunction clinics in this country. You take a string of postage stamps, you lick them at one end, and you wrap them around his penis, and the next morning, if the stamps have been torn loose, the guy had an erection in his head. This is beautiful. This is like $6 you get a lab result. This is incredible. This is so cool. Of course, insurance won't reimburse me for the damn stuff. It's great. I've got red hair. At some point, it's really going to get on the screen. Okay, let's jump to the next subject here before I embarrass myself further. Your immune system. So back when you're dealing with a short-term stressor running for your life, your immune system's defenses are enhanced. If you're chronically stressed, though, something very different happens. Your immune system is suppressed. Aha! So what about this prediction? So if chronic stress chronically suppresses the immune system, if you are chronically stressed, there's all sorts of infectious diseases you should now be at more risk for, and when you get them, they should bowl you over. And this is the central premise of this whole field that started about 20 years ago, psychoneuroimmunology. The notion that what's going on here affects the immune defenses throughout your body. And what's clear at this point in the field is that's exactly how it works for the boring stuff. If you are under stress, the common cold becomes more common, you're more at risk for mononucleosis, more at risk for cold sore flare-ups, herpes viral reactivation. What's unclear is about the more significant infectious diseases. For example, if you have AIDS, immune system declining, if you are under severe stress during that time, does the immune system decline faster? Jury is still out on that. One thing, though, that is clear is the number one connection on everybody's list in this realm, which is stress related to cancer. And everybody knows the answer to this. Stress can cause cancer. Stress can make a tumor that's already there grow faster. Stress can make you more likely to come out of remission. Stress causes cancer. This is so well known that a few years ago, a paper in JAMA, General American Medical Association, looking at women who had just gotten a metastatic breast cancer diagnosis, and they were asked, what do you think was the cause of your cancer? And by more than a 2-to-1 margin, the most common answer was, stress. Stress caused my cancer. Stress has next to nothing to do with cancer. There's never been a decent prospective study of humans showing that stress increases cancer risk. When you look at the laboratory studies, there are mechanisms by which stress will make tumors grow faster. My lab has done some of that work, but it turns out it's virtually irrelevant to human cancer. This is a realm where there is not a strong connection. Why is it important to emphasize this? Because there are all sorts of highly credentialed quacks out there making a fortune off of cancer patients saying, my special brand of stress management, credit cards accepted, will slow down your cancer, stop it, reverse it. There's no scientific basis. Stress management will make people more able to comply with miserable cancer protocols, but stress itself has essentially nothing to do with biology of cancer. Bad medicine, bad research, bad clinical practice, ultimately bad ethics. So that's one domain where we don't have to worry about stuff. Okay, well, let's go back to stuff we do need to worry about. Okay, so back to our last category again. Those same stress hormones that get into your brain short-term and make you think more clearly, all of that long-term do disastrous things to your brain. In one part of the brain called the hippocampus, a brain region central to learning and memory, stress damages neurons there, causes them to atrophy, makes them more likely to die from other insults, blocks your hippocampus from making new neurons. This is work my lab has spent 30 years on, trying to figure out where does stress get off killing your brain cells. In another part of the brain called the amygdala, something very different happens. The amygdala is about fear and anxiety. What does stress do to the amygdala? It makes neurons grow bigger and form new connections and become more excitable. That's why stress puts you more at risk for an anxiety disorder. Your amygdala gets much better at learning to be afraid of things you don't need to be afraid of. People with post-traumatic stress disorder, their amygdalas get bigger and are hyperreactive. Meanwhile, another part of the brain, the region that releases that dopamine stuff having to do with pleasure and reward cocaine, works on the dopamine system. With chronic stress, the dopamine system there shuts down. What if you just explained why stress puts you at risk for major depression? The defining symptom of a depression is anhedonia. Hedonism, the pursuit of pleasure, anhedonia, the inability to feel pleasure. This is the neurochemistry by which stress puts us more at risk for major clinical depression. Finally, there's this wonderful part of the brain called the frontal cortex. Frontal cortex, it's the most recently evolved part of the human brain. We've got more of it proportionally than any other species. What does the frontal cortex do? It makes you do the harder thing when it's the right thing to do. It does gratification postponement and long-term planning and impulse control and emotional regulation. What does stress do in the frontal cortex? It causes atrophy of neurons there. What does this explain? This explains why during a period of stress you make the most dumbass decision that seems brilliant at the time and you spend the rest of your life paying for it during periods of stress. Our judgment goes out the window, our ability to regulate our emotions, our ability to regulate impulses, impaired on that front. Okay, so by this point, if you're still awake, you should be depressed as hell. Okay, let me make it worse. One last stress-related disease. This is like stress for 2000. Have any of you in here heard of a disease called idiopathic alopecia areata? Okay, so hands here. This is the profoundly rare state of someone who is so traumatized by some stressful event that over the next few days, their hair turns white or falls out. This is for real. This is a real disorder. People understand the biology of what goes on in the hair follicles and the stress hormones. It's once in a career that you see this nonetheless as real. Look at this. You're chronically stressed. You get hypertension. You get diabetes. You get flatulence. Your sex life is ruined. Your brain gets damaged and your hair falls out. How is it any of us are still functioning here? What's clear is, despite all of that, most of us have not collapsed into puddles of stress-related disease. Most of us cope. And what's been clear from day one in the field is some organisms are always better at coping with stress than others. And thus what I want to look at in the last couple of minutes here is why do some bodies, and more importantly, why do some psyches deal better with stress than others? What are the mechanisms that explain individual differences in vulnerability to stress-related disease? Now, if we're talking about individual differences, we're not talking about physical stress. Finish the lecture here, go outside, unexpectedly get gored by a rhino, and you're going to have a stress response. There's no way out of it. You can't psychologically reframe your experience. You grow from adversity and appreciate the opportunity. You're going to have a stress response. Finish the lecture, go outside, and have some kind of a tense, weird, ambiguous interaction with a friend, and only some of us would have a stress response. Why is it that this gray zone of sort of ambiguous social circumstances can stress some of us more than others? Now, what I'm essentially asking here is, what is it that makes psychological stress stressful? And it turns out a massive amount of research has shown exactly what the building blocks are of psychological stress. And this schematic summarizes a gazillion studies. Okay, top line, you've got a lab rat in a cage. Every now and then, the rat gets a shock. Over the course of these shocks, its blood pressure goes up, its stress hormone levels, its increased risk of an ulcer. You're giving the rat a stress-related disease. Now, second line, there is a second rat. Psychology jargon, the second rat is yoked to the first. They're both in cages with electric grids. Every time the first rat gets a shock, so does the second. Same intensity, same duration, same everything. According to Hans Selye in the 1930s, both of these rats' bodies are being thrown out of homeostatic balance in the exact same, except there's a critical difference, which is every time that second rat gets a shock, he could go over to the other side of the cage where there's another rat, and he could sit down next to it and bite the crap out of it with his teeth. And you know what? There's rats not getting ulcers. The guy he's biting is getting an ulcer. He's got an outlet for his frustration. Next line. Now we have second rat yoked to the first. Every time the first one gets shocked, so does the second, same duration, same everything. But every time the second rat gets a shock, it can go over to the other side of the cage where there's a bar of wood that he could gnaw on with his teeth. And he doesn't get an ulcer. He has a hobby. This way, the second rat is getting the same shocks as the first guy, but 10 seconds before each shock, the original warning light comes on, and he doesn't get an ulcer. For the same external stressor, you were more at risk for a stress-related disease if you got no predictive information. A warning light is protective. It tells you when is it coming, how bad is it going to be, how long is it going to last. And we all know that principle. Every time we say to the dentist, are we almost done? Give me some predictive information here. And we know that when the dentist says, yes, two more bits of drilling when we're done, we've just gotten bad news, we're not done yet. But we've also gotten good news, we know when we are finally safe. For the rat in the first line, without a warning light, any second you are a half second away from the next stressor. What predictability does is allow you to plan your coping strategy during the stressor, and more importantly, it lets you know when you're finally safe. Next version. Now, this is a rat who's been trained to press a lever. By pressing the lever, he is less likely to get a shock. Today, he's in the cage, and he's getting the same exact shocks as the first guy, but the lever's in there, but the lever's disconnected, he's doing nothing at all, but he doesn't know that. He's in there, pounding away on the lever, saying, this is great, just imagine how many shocks he'd be getting otherwise. He also has control. For the same external stressor, it feels less stressful if we feel as if we are in control of the circumstances. Finally, jumping a line here, finally, rat's getting the shocks, and now it can go over to the other side of the cage where there's another rat that it knows, and they like each other, and they groom each other, and he doesn't get an ulcer. Ooh, science has finally proven friends are good for your health. Science has proven this big time. In all of health psychology and behavioral medicine, the two biggest predictors of mortality outcome both tap into all of these issues. First one is never, ever make the mistake in this country of being born into a poor family, because your health is going to pay for it the rest of your life. Socioeconomic status and health, the main mediator, a ton of research now has shown, is the stress of the social subordination poverty. The second one is, if you've got a choice in the matter, don't be socially isolated. Classic studies showing that the same infectious diseases, when you look at the most socially isolated individuals and the most socially affiliated, significant others, small group of good friends, community activity that you're intensely involved with, for any of those, across the spectrum of infectious diseases, almost a threefold difference in the mortality rate. And that's how you control for stuff like, ooh, people who live alone just eat Cheetos for dinner every night. Control for that stuff, and social isolation is an aching stressor and a huge health risk factor for every primate out there, including us. So what is it that makes psychological stress stressful? For the same external reality, for the same external stressful unpleasantry, you are more likely to subjectively feel stressed, more likely to turn on the stress response, and more likely to get a stress-related disease if you feel like you have no control over what's happening. You have no predictive information. You have no outlets from frustration. You interpret things as getting worse, and you don't have anybody's shoulder to cry on. And basically, this is the place to stop. For that simple reason, none of us in here are getting ulcers because leopards are chasing us at dawn or we're having axe fights trying to get enough food to eat. We instead have this bizarre westernized luxury that we're getting stressed by these psychosocial things we're making up in our heads. And that's the critical final point. To the extent that we're smart enough to have invented this stuff and foolish enough to then fall for it, we all have the potential to be wise enough to instead keep it in perspective. So on that note, good luck with your stressors, and thank you. condition, then I got the hiccups. Good evening. My name is Kelton. I'm a DJ. And my question is, when talking about homeostasis balance, in what way do the stressors change when the status quo of the homeostasis balance changes? For instance, when a woman goes through menopause.
Great, great question. If you're sort of in the know in this field, you'll realize my using the word homeostasis is embarrassingly outdated by about 20 years. But 20 years ago, a new trendy term swept in the field called allostasis. And it's much of it is sort of Zen mumbo jumbo, but sort of the most sort of realistic feature of replacing the homeostatic concept with the allostatic concept is the notion that what counts as being homeostatically balanced changes in different circumstances. And what counts as the blood pressure you want when you're sound asleep should be different than when you're running for your life, than when you are prepubescent versus when you're pregnant, versus when you're postmenopausal, and what your body is very adept at is shifting the set point as to what counts as the optimal sort of homeostatic point of balance, the body shifts dramatically. And thus what you wind up seeing is the body is not only very, very good at realizing when it is out of whack in terms of being homeostatically imbalanced, but it also has to accommodate the fact that what counts as normal is very different in different circumstances. Great example of this work by a guy named John Wingfield at UC Davis, looking at birds who migrate from Baja in California up to Alaska. What he shows is this amazing sort of relativism that they experience. When you're down in Baja, it's supposed to be 80 degrees. When you're up in Alaska, it's supposed to be 20 degrees. And 20 degrees in Alaska is perfectly normal, and the bodies of these birds have no stress responses at the time. If it's 60 degrees in Baja instead of 80 degrees, these birds have massive stress responses. In other words, 60 degrees in Baja is much more of a threat to the life of these animals than 20 degrees up in the Aleutians, and their bodies show it. What counts as normal shifts dramatically. The body has to be really sophisticated to be able to do that. It's a great question.
Thank you.
Hello, my name's Lisa. My husband is a holistic veterinarian here in Spokane, and we talk about his work quite a bit. One of the things that he sees a lot is that when people are stressed out, their pets are sick, that there's a real correlation between what's happening with the person and the pet. And we also know that pets can help relieve people's stress. And I'm wondering what you know about that relationship between the animals and the people and the relief of stress, or even person to person. If one person's stressed, does the person they live with automatically get stressed also?
Well, it probably depends on how much they irritate you in the process of your stress. Dogs are amazing at that. I mean, in terms of synthetic biology, this very trendy term, dogs are the most amazing example of synthetic biology. When we invented them 20,000 years ago out of wolves, and sort of the symbiosis we have with this, a much more studied example of the sort of synchrony of stress responses is studies people have done of mother-infant interactions. And what you see is very well-attached infants and mothers, you will see things like synchronizing of breathing rates when they're together, synchronizing of heart rates, and remarkable synchrony of some aspects of the stress response there. We are profoundly social creatures. We're not getting stressed because of locusts. We're getting stressed or we're getting relieved of stress because of the nature of our interactions with other members of our own species or these weirdo phyto things that are sort of like surrogate members of our species. So it's not surprising at all that there is both an infectiousness of being stressed as well as an infectiousness of being relieved from stress.
Thank you.
First off, thanks for being here tonight. It's been an honor to listen to you speak about it. So thank you for coming to Spokane and being part of this tonight. My question is, we've been talking a little bit about the difference between a perceived threat and a reality of threat. So obviously, being worried about a rhino is something that may actually happen and all of here, but it could actually happen and there's going to be a response. But I think we've been talking a lot about the perception of a threat and getting worried, our body reacting to a stressful environment when we're not going to be killed when we're sitting at our office desk. We're not going to be killed when we're in our bed at night, but yet we're worried, 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 worried about the society. the past 6 or 7 years of the Great Recession that's been going on, I think, causing a lot of stress on top of all of us as well. So I guess the question is, what are some of the things we can do to help alleviate stress from the perception of a threat versus an actual threat?
And that's a fabulous point, and sort of something really to emphasize in kind of the world of stress and stress management. Ooh, stressors, we're not being chased by lions, we're having these psychological stressors, it's highly, highly perceptual, it's all the way we interpret the world around us, thus with the right perceptions we can turn our hells into heavens. That's great for the world of neurotic middle class and upper middle class people. If your stressors are you don't have a place to sleep tonight, or you're a refugee, or you're dying of a terminal disease, no degree of chanting of mantras are going to make much of a dent in it there. Everything I've talked about here is the world of sort of westernized neurotic luxuries of stress. But within that world, it is overwhelmingly interpretive. And what that's about is huge, huge versions in terms of controlling it, versions of the give me the wisdom to know the difference between what I can change and what I can't, to accept the things that I can't change, to tell the difference between information that's useful versus that which is superfluous, to tell the difference between true social support and intimacy versus acquaintances who you've been suckered into thinking are actually intimate. All these ways in which we realize if I could get my perception of things, if I realize this truly is not as important as it seemed, what really matters in life, this was a wake-up call, all those things that all of us are awful at, but the reality is that that is what these stressors are about. Great example of that, which is something that we could do psychologically. All of us belong to multiple hierarchies. We're not baboons, we're not chimps who come with a single number of the dominance hierarchy. We belong to all sorts of hierarchies, and what we're amazing at doing psychologically is we will have different ranks and different hierarchies that we're part of. Is we are very good at rationalizing away the importance of the ones that we're low ranking in and conflating the importance of the ones we're high ranking in. You have the world's lousiest job in some gigantic corporation, but you're the captain of the company softball team this year, and you better bet which one of those. You know you're going to be sitting there saying, 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, that's crap, that doesn't matter. Here's what really matters. What really matters is I'm the deacon of my church. What really matters is I'm respected, and even though my socioeconomic status, my rank, my whatever, my civil service grade, any of these things, what we're very good at is psychologically manipulating the different hierarchies that we're part of to find self-esteem out of the ones we're highest ranking in. And that's sort of the prescription as to how you do all of these, finding your footholds of control and predictability, telling the difference between true social support and just sort of transient acquaintanceship, all of those things. None of those are easy. None of us have the patience to do that. It's all very hard, but it all pays off.
Yeah. Suppose you've been handling stress very poorly for decades, and you walk out of here tonight and start handling stress very well, thanks to your lecture. Does the damage that I've already endured stop when I don't have any control? Can I push it back the other way?
Oh, this isn't about this guy, you know? What a good ass. Somewhere I heard of. Okay, me too. What you find is there is virtually no outpost of stress-related disease that causes irrevocable damage. And there are all sorts of ways in which the body is vastly more resilient than anybody ever thought of in the past. As just one example, if you took introductory neuroscience any time for the last 5,000 years, the first thing they teach you is the adult brain does not make new neurons. Biggest revolution in neurobiology in the last 2 decades, adult neurogenesis, the adult brain does make new neurons in response to learning, stimulation, environmental enrichment, exercise. 90-year-olds who were put in a more stimulating environment make new neurons, which can correct for some neurons. So all these outposts are good news. There's no domain virtually of any stress-related illness where the damage is irrevocable. There is no domain of stress-related damage to the body where the more time that has gone by, the more of an uphill battle it's going to be. So it's doable, but with each passing day, it's harder and harder. Like most of the things in life, as it seems.
This is the
In the book, you talked about chronic stress. There was nothing in there that gave an idea of that. Is there something good about this? Like, it causes the species to change its behavior.
Okay. What chronic stress does in the long time in terms of sort of evolutionary versions of in the long run, that one people debate a lot, and there's this whole world of like Darwinian medicine, people talking about what are the evolutionary advantages of certain psychiatric diseases that evolve in a much sort of more manageable domain. What you bring up is this fantastic point, which is all stress is not bad. The purpose of studying this sort of thing is not to free us of stress. That's not the goal whatsoever, because we love stress. We love stress when it's the right kind. We pay good money to be stressed by the right kind of stress, to be terrified in a scary movie, or get on a roller coaster ride, and we have ways of describing what good stress is. We call it stimulation. We call it excitement. And of course, what becomes sort of the challenge is, how do you like tell the difference? You know, somebody strokes your cheek, and this could be nice and stimulating. Somebody rubs your cheek with a piece of sandpaper for 8 hours, that probably counts as stressful. Where do the rules go is sort of where the boundaries are. As a general rule, the stressors that we like are moderate in severity, and they're transient. It's not for nothing roller coaster rides are not 3 weeks long. It's not for nothing that when you get on one, you think the risk is you may get off a little bit queasy, not that you're going to be decapitated along the way. What we like are stressors that are only moderately severe and transient, and they occur in a setting that overall feels benevolent. Because when we feel safe overall, we love giving away a sense of control and predictability. We call it play. We call it being surprised. We call it fun. What do dogs do when they're playing? The more dominant one is the one that crouches down and says, I'm suspending our dominance relationship here for a while, so you are safe, and to prove how safe you are messing around with me now, you can put your teeth on my throat, on my crotch, and we're all great pals here. That's what play is. It is in a benevolent setting. We love to be surprised and to have given up some control and predictability. We call it stimulation. And of course, what becomes stressful is when it is too severe, when it is too prolonged. And of course, what the biggest challenge is try to make sense of individual differences. Why one person's like living life to its most reckless excitement is like bird watching at dawn, and somebody else is becoming a mercenary in Zimbabwe or something. Where do individual differences come from? That is like a whole world of mysteries at this point. But your point here is absolutely critical. It is not the rule. Our job is to make sure there is no stress in life. We love the right kind of stress, and we thrive on it. Okay, thank you.